For us to understand the history of the colored people in Zimbabwe, although the appropriate term is mixed race, we need to go back to 1890, when colonial rule began in Zimbabwe, aided by the British South Africa Company with funding from Cecil John Rhodes. If you like the work that I do on this channel, please consider partnering with me on Patreon. From as little as $3, you can help me improve the quality and consistency of videos on this channel. On that note, help me thank my biggest Patreon, Tom Bodkin. Thank you so much for the support. Now, prior to that, Zimbabwe was dominated by black Africans with two dominant tribes, the Mashona and Ndebele. But that is not to say it did not have any mixed race people living there. There's a very high likelihood, though, since for hundreds of years Zimbabwe had been a major trade center and had seen countless visits from the Portuguese and other Europeans who had been frequenting the areas for mining and missionary work. You can watch my video on the history of the Great Zimbabwe, I'll leave a card above. After the first Chimrenga uprisings in 1896, which led to the killing of about 10% of white settlers, it became evident to the white settlers that they needed to come up with a plan to manage the Africans so as to avoid another uprising. This would come to be known as the Native Question. What would follow was a series of legislation that was meant to take power from the Africans and empower the settlers. In 1898, the British officially recognized the name Rhodesia for the colony after promulgating the Rhodesia Order in Council. The Order in Council was the governing instrument of Rhodesia until 1923, when the settlers were accorded responsible government. One of their immediate challenges was to avoid the mixing of the races. The white male settlers, who considered themselves a superior race, were fearful of the African males having sexual relations with their European women and possible outcomes of racial swamping. This collective fear would come to be known as the Black Peril. This would lead to the formulation of some bizarre laws, like the 1898 sale of liquor to natives and Indian regulations. The settlers believed that Africans were like infants and would not be able to handle European liquor. In the same year, the settlers also passed the Native Locations and Ordinance, a law passed to keep Africans out of white residential areas. In 1903, the settlers would go on to pass the Immorality Suppression Ordinance of 1903, which prohibited voluntary sexual encounters between white women and black men. Now, it's worth noting that no such prohibition existed for white men in their relations with black women. Those found guilty would eventually serve a maximum sentence of 2 years if you were a white woman, and 5 years for black men. Furthermore, black men could be condemned to death for any act legally defined as attempted rape. However, most times the settler community would mete out justice on innocent African men by downplaying the role that some white women may have played in initiating sexual relations with their black servants for purposes of self-gratification or just out of curiosity. Actually, there were 46 recorded cases of white women who used their authority as employers of black men to persuade them to have sexual relations with them between 1899 and 1914. Sexual relations between white women and black men were not that uncommon, and that it was only when a white woman involved with a black man was exposed that she would cry rape. And in some instances, if the black man was reluctant to have sexual relations with a white woman, he would be falsely reported as having attempted to rape the mistress. It is recorded that no less than 20 African men were charged and executed for sexual assault of white women, while approximately 200 others were either imprisoned or flogged between 1902 and 1935. In 1916, the Order in Council went on to enact the Immorality and Indecency Suppression Ordinance of 1916, further criminalizing the actions of African men. Despite all this legislation, the growing number of children of mixed race was testimony to the prevalence of white male and black female sexual relations over time. It was recorded that white males would call African women stinking Kaffirs, a derogatory term, but under the cover of darkness, have sexual relations with them. Though white settler women made several attempts to have legislation passed prohibiting these relations, they for the most part failed until the 1950s, because in doing so, they were perceived to be challenging the authority of the white men who wielded most of the power in society. Initially, the shortage of white women was attributed to this phenomenon. In Bulawayo, for instance, in 1897, white male settlers outnumbered their female counterparts 6-1. Even after this disparity was eventually resolved, the male settler community continued having sexual relations with the local African women, with some going to the extent of marrying and having children with African women. Now, this phenomenon was not only reserved to the lower class white male settlers. Some very notable names in Rhodesia, including the big game hunter Frederick Courtney Selu, Willie Edwards, Stephanus Barnard, Peter Forrestal, among others, had African wives and children, though they never wanted it to be known publicly. The settlers went on to the extent of omitting this information in their publications. This also led to the neglect of many mixed-race children. Numerous complaints against such an example letter directed to the Office of the Law Department by the Rhodesia Colored Society in 1929. The letter read, "We ask the government if the government can help us against our fathers. Of course they don't look after us because they know that they are natives, women. They are going to have children with them. We beg the government to put up the law against these Europeans who have native women. The thing that made us to ask this is because they still go forward making more children and leave them again. The poor native women have to carry very hard to support these children." In the 1930s, after the racist Land Apportionment Act was promulgated, Rhodesia was being purely shaped into a fully segregated society, with the distinction between black and white communities being clearly defined. Indians and mixed-race people found an intermediate status in the Rhodesian racial hierarchy. And whilst Africans were relegated to the reserves in the rural areas, mixed-race people were accommodated in the urban areas. Originally, the first black and colored neighborhood was on the Southside area of the Salisbury Kopi and Pioneer Street, which is modern-day Kagovi Street. During the course of time, government and commercial buildings dominated central Harare, displacing blacks and coloreds into Highfield and Acadia, respectively. The colonial government permitted colored and Indians to live with them in segregated neighborhoods reserved for Europeans. This is also evidenced by the number of buildings in Harare and Bulawayo, which were built by Indians, something that Africans were not able to do. Asians and coloreds also had access to white hospitals and schools and other amenities and had some voting powers, at least until the Rhodesian Front removed this right in its 1969 constitution. Those privileges also extended to the workplace, where 30% of the colored population was employed by the Rhodesian manufacturing sector, the remainder being tradesmen or engaged in service delivery, usually in roles that Africans could not access. Coloreds from African families were excluded from these privileges. The colored communities in southern Rhodesia mainly had emigrated as servants of Afrikaners and other white South African settlers from the Cape of Good Hope, and those who were offspring of the local white community and African mothers. During the Second Chimurenga, conscription was enforced on all male coloreds of military age who were expected to contribute 4 to 5 months of service to the Rhodesian security forces. In 1966, the Minister of Defense gave notice that it would henceforth extend conscriptions to all foreigners with residency status, making coloreds of South African and other nationalities in Rhodesia also liable for military service. Most colored recruits were assigned to the reinforcement holding unit, which was primarily concerned with transport and logistics. They were also tasked with providing convoy security and guarding installations targeted for sabotage by insurgents. In 1978, the reinforcement holding unit was reorganized into the Rhodesian Defense Regiment. As the war intensified, colored personnel deployed to operational areas successfully petitioned to receive the same pay as white soldiers. On the advent of independence in 1980, following the triumph of Robert Mugabe, there were 20,000 coloreds living in the country. All coloreds who registered in the Rhodesian electoral system prior to 31 December 1979 were permitted to vote, and those that did overwhelmingly voted and endorsed the Rhodesian Front. Nonetheless, Robert Mugabe would later nominate Calverwell, a leading member of the colored community, to the Zimbabwean Senate as a conciliatory gesture. During the Second Chimurenga War, black nationalists frequently decried coloreds as having benefited unjustly from the colonial racial hierarchy. At the height of the land reform program in Zimbabwe, Zimbabwean Minister of Education and Culture, Enias Chikwedere, demanded that coloureds be excluded from the redistribution process on racial grounds, insisting that if we give them land, it will be giving it back to the white man. Recently, some mixed race groupings have been trying to make overtures to the ZANU-PF government, seeking empowerment opportunities. They are claiming that they have been marginalized and deserve the same opportunities as Africans. That, in a nutshell, is the history of mixed race people in Zimbabwe. If you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. If you haven't subscribed already, please do so. Don't forget to partner with me on Patreon. Link in the description. See you in the next video.